Wow. That's a big screen.
Hey there, crazies. A couple months ago, I got a personal tour of the computing facility at Argonne National Lab, just outside Chicago. I've been trying to find a way to make this footage work as a science video, but the whole thing just feels more like a vlog. So I'm just gonna geek out for a few minutes. First, there was a tour of the actual supercomputer room. This is Mira, a supercomputer. And this is Haritha. She's the head of user experience. Basically, she's the point of contact for any scientists hoping to use the machines. I feel like I'm grossly understating her job. She really knows her stuff.
And at that point, it was an IBM machine, IBM BGP machine. That was Intrepid. The next generation is Mira, which is still in production. It's an IBM BGQ machine. And this is our newest supercomputer, Theta, which is an Intel Cray machine.
So how many of these are in there?
I will show you. We can go walk through that. So this is one node board.
Right.
And one cabinet has 32 node board. Each node board has 32 of these node cards.
Okay.
So on the whole, we have like 1,024 nodes per cabinet. Node has 16 cores.
Okay.
So you're going to do 49,152 times. And that's how many cores are available to you to use.
That's wild.
So here's a summary. Mira has nodes. Each node has a 16-core IBM A2 processor available for use. There are 32 nodes per node board, 32 node boards per cabinet, and three rows of 16 cabinets, which makes for a grand total of 786,432 cores.
And that's really our unit of currency for the scientists.
Right, that's powerful.
The processing power of a computer is usually measured in flops, or floating point operations per second. The Intel Core i7 processor I have in my computer runs at 230 gigaflops. That's 230 billion floating point operations per second. At peak performance, Mira runs at about 10 petaflops, and Theta runs at 11.7 petaflops. That's 50,000 times more powerful than my home computer. Something else really cool about Mira is the way they keep it cool. See what I did there? I mean, listen to this thing.
And like I said, you know, this is one cabinet. It has about 30 cores.
Okay, and these are water cooled.
This is water cooled.
Okay.
So quiet! Each of the node boards in Mira has a tube transporting cold water past all the nodes. The water absorbs the heat and carries it away. No fans means no motors, which means no noise. In fact, the noise you're hearing here isn't from Mira. It's from Theta, on the other side of the room. Theta is fan-cooled, so it's much louder. Also, quick side note. These supercomputers are so heavy, the floor underneath them needs support. That support is expensive, so they only added it to some of the floor. The dark tiles are supported floor, and the white tiles are unsupported floor. When they bring in new cabinets for installation, they have to walk them around the outside wall or they'll fall through the floor. Okay, so after the computer room, we went upstairs to the visualization lab, or VisLab for short, where I got to see how they actually interact with the supercomputer.
Wow. It's a big screen.
So this is our visualization lab.
This is Joe. He's in charge of the VisLab.
What our team does largely is works with folks that are doing large-scale simulations on the resources downstairs, takes the data that they're producing, and generates visualizations out of them to help enable them to get insight out of them.
Okay, so these are all projects?
Yes, yeah, so these are all various projects from data either produced on Mira or Theta, or some of it's a little bit older, so it was on a previous machine, but on ALCF resources. Multiple reasons for having a large scale display. A little bit is the wow factor, right?
Right.
Some of it is enabling. We often do tours where there's large numbers of people, right? So enabling lots of people to come into space. But actually, one of the other important reasons is that because the scale of the data continues to grow, so each one of these displays, you can kind of see the tiles, right?
Right.
Each one of those is a 1080p, 1920 by 1080. So having a physically large display that has a large number of pixels gives me both of those things. Right, so I can stand back and see context, or I can walk directly up and I can see the fine detail.
So they have a bunch of HD screens linked together, acting as one screen. And they do this for two reasons. One, if they're giving a tour to a large group, it's nice to have them all in a common space looking at the same screen. Two, there's a ton of data. The resolution on these simulations is absolutely enormous. You'd never be able to see everything on a single screen. I mean, someone did a simulation of the large-scale structure of the universe.
Multiple people can drag content, so it's essentially through a browser, right? So I have a browser here on my phone, and I can use that to interact with the display. I can play this movie. Multiple people can do that at the same time, drag and drop on their laptop,
right?
Content into their browser, and essentially have that content transferred to the server that's driving the display. To give you an idea of the scale.
Right.
So this is really just a minuscule part.
That little tiny piece, yeah.
Fluid dynamics is also a popular choice for supercomputers because it's complicated.
How the overall flow patterns and structure cause this particle buildup on the wall, the aneurysm that could potentially lead to this weakness in the wall or in its burst, right, which would obviously be catastrophic, or a portion of the clot to break free, causing obstruction downstream. The goal is to identify cases where that is going to be a problem, and then you can go in and do something preventative. But also identify cases where it's not likely to cause a problem, so then you don't, do something invasive like cut someone's head.
No big deal for supercomputers, apparently. Not only is all this data generated in record time, it also has to be stored for later use. The storage itself isn't that big of a problem. You can just stack up more drives. I'll let Haritha put that in perspective.
You know, when I do tours, I try to kind of explain, how can you make that tangible? So I read somewhere that the functional memories of 800 human beings is about 1 petabyte.
Okay.
Okay.
And you have access to 7 petabytes. So
okay. Maybe that's more tangible. I don't know.
The real limiting factor with supercomputers is write speed. No, seriously. The data is being generated so fast that it literally can't even be written to permanent storage fast enough. They can display it on the screen in real time, but then a bunch of it is just gone. So much science lost. Some of the data is even three-dimensional, so they're working on a VR interface that I got to play around with for a few minutes. So cool! Anyway, that's all for now, crazies. Hopefully I'll get a chance to go back and see more. If you want to learn more about the significance of this simulation, you should check out my Universe Explained playlist over on the Science Asylum. And as usual, I'll see you in the comments.